Well, I didn't really expect such a change of scene, leaving Glen Morrison and climbing into the hills. On the map it looks bleak, but far from being bleak, you're going through woodlands at first, natural woodlands beside the river, and then as you climb up, you're coming into the remains of the Caledonian Forest. You can just see the grey stumps of the trees, and I imagine these were burned down at one time, probably to make grazings for sheep, although a few old stalwarts are still standing. And one of the joys is the way the scene keeps changing, because what you're doing is you're following the River Doe and then curving up below a peak called An Rith, which means the ram. And at the junction of Burns, you've got to be sure to take the middle corrie. But it's very easy to find because there's a wee bridge there. And when you turn the corner, you're facing the main corrie, a great amphitheatre of rocky hills. And today, it's just a perfect day to be here with a warm sun. Everything's very dry. This is one of the driest summers that anybody can remember here. The seven men of Glen Morrison were seven who had dedicated themselves to fighting every evil which had come out of the Hanoverian takeover. Now, the takeover was this, that Cumberland had moved down into Fort Augustus, and using loyal Highlandmen, he called them, mainly Campbells, they were raising the countryside, stealing cattle, taking people out of fields and shooting them, raping women. The whole object was to clear the whole area 50 miles around Fort Augustus. And these seven men had carried out a very successful private war, and that Glengarry lad knew where to find them. But first of all, he'd come over these mountains. The prince, the boy, and the three companions of the prince spent a miserable night up there. Then in the following morning, they came down here into the middle corrie, and this is Rory's refuge. And the prince spent four marvellous days here fattening up, and I'm going inside to see it. Well, the prince described himself as being as comfortably lodged as in a royal palace, with a fine purling stream close to his bed. And he certainly did well, because he was being fed on mutton, ox meat, whiskey, cheese, butter. And I believe he was very fond of cooking. He loved to stir the soup. I can imagine him here, tanned like a gypsy, wearing an old black kilt and a hanky around his head to keep the midges off, because apparently it was pretty bad for midges at that time. And lots of things were done, but I think the most interesting thing is that he said that this was the first Privy Council that he'd established since Culloden, and the Privy Council were the seven men who swore an oath of fealty to him, that they would never divulge where he was, that they would stick by him at all times and see him through. Very, very solemnly done. There was also a lot of humour, because they loved to talk to the prince about his future and about his girlfriends. And the prince had taught himself to speak Gaelic, and they found him a great companion. He was apparently never known to complain here. Small wonder. However, Utopia came to an end, because inside the 4 days, they heard that Black Campbell was only 4 miles away, rounding up cattle and heading this way. So there was only one way to go, and that was over that ridge, climbing up to 3,000 feet again. Hard walking, and the prince's party, descending from 3,000 feet, had arrived in Glenafric, at the very end of Lochafric. And they had 20 miles to go, because they were heading for the Braes of Strathglass. And however hard it might be for anybody in daylight, they were doing it in the darkness. And that's what must have made these journeys pretty grim. And the reason why they were heading for Strathglass was there was a lot of safe places, little huts, that they might be able to use, because they had something in their mind. And that something was to try to find out news of a ship said to be lying at Pulieu. And on the walk, they met an eighth man, Hugh Macmillan,
So the seven men became eight men, and Hugh Macmillan and the other seven determined they would stay with the prince until he was handed over safely and could escape towards that ship. And I'm going to go to the furthest north of his travels, which is just over the hill there in Glencannich. That hill behind me is called Benacharn, and it lies above Glencannich, and that's the furthest north that Charlie reached. He left Rory's cave on the night of the 2nd of August, and on the 3rd he spent the day lying up here. And in the morning of the 4th, two scouts set off from here, two of his men, to walk to Poulieu across the hills 40 miles away to bring news of this French ship. And Charlie waited on top of the hill there on the day of the 6th, waiting for news. And then they went down to a hut, and in the morning they got the news, and it wasn't too good. The French ship had sailed, but they heard that it had landed two gentlemen who were on their way to Lochiel's country. So Charlie's party crossed the ridges again to the dark mile of sombre association.